high-mass stars, in contrast to low-mass stars, have a different set of processes that occur during the red giant stage and beyond. So what happens to a high-mass star? And remember, high-mass stars are those that have masses greater than 8 solar masses. During the red giant stage, when the helium core has begun fusing into carbon and oxygen, a high-mass star will reach a point where the core is all carbon and oxygen, and instead of ending its life when it is become a carbon-oxygen core, like a low-mass star, it will actually have enough mass for gravity to collapse the carbon and oxygen core down to enough pressure, density, and temperature to fuse those atoms into higher, into heavier elements. And so what elements can be produced? Things heavier than carbon and oxygen for sure, neon, silicon, and elements all the way up to iron on the periodic table. There's a saying that we're all made up of star stuff, and it's true. The material that stars make in their red giant lifetimes, in their cores, is the same material that is now part of the Earth and part of our bodies. Here is a schematic showing the layers, not really to scale, but just showing layers at the end of a high-mass star's red giant lifetime. The heaviest element that a high-mass star is able to produce through nuclear fusion in its core is iron, with the symbol Fe. So that's what we have at the core. When the core of the star is completely iron, that will be the end of the high-mass star's red giant lifetime, and then something else will occur. On top of that iron core are many shells of the elements that have been produced during that end of the red giant lifetime. So silicon, oxygen, neon, carbon, helium, and then finally on top of that is a hydrogen burning shell, and on top of that is the rest of the non-burning or non-fusing hydrogen that makes up that high-mass star. So at this point, when the iron core has been produced during this red giant phase, gravity will win, and gravity will win big time because the iron core is not fusing. It's not generating any new energy, and so it won't sustain any outward gas pressure. Gravity will collapse the star down. So when a high-mass star gets to the end of its red giant lifetime, the core and the outer layers have no more fuel for nuclear fusion and generating energy, which supports the star against the crushing pressures of gravity. Because of this, the star then collapses. The mass of the core, however, is so high that nothing can counteract the gravitational collapse at this point. And so everything collapses, including the core. What occurs at this point is a massive star supernova, or what astronomers call a type 2 supernova. The collapsing layers collapse against and then bounce off the very dense collapsed core of the star. And this event is called a the outer layers of the star collapse down onto the crushed core of the star. The resulting shockwave from this is what triggers the explosion of a massive star supernova, what we call the type 2 supernova. And during this event, heavy elements can be created from additional fusion and neutron capture events, elements from magnesium, lead, or gold. We often say in astronomy that an event like this had to happen before our sun formed. When we look at our sun, we see that it's made up of atoms that the sun itself cannot create, so heavy elements that only could have been made inside of high-mass stars. And so a high-mass star or type 2 supernova had to have happened in the vicinity of our sun before our sun formed. And that material, which was expelled during the supernova event, was then accumulated into the cloud of gas and dust that made our protostar sun. And so we are quite literally made up of star stuff. So high-mass stars, they collapse because of gravity. With no outward pressure, there's an implosion onto the core and with the core itself. This implosion leads to a supernova. So I mentioned before that the infalling matter rebounds, and part of that rebound is what causes the shockwave explosion that causes the supernova. But there's also a massive amount of neutrinos that are produced during the collapse of the iron core of a high-mass star. Normally, neutrinos that are produced don't affect normal matter, but because so many are produced at this point, they actually exert an outward pressure that helps the star explosively expand outward. We have evidence for this because a star was observed to have exploded in 1987, and this star exploded in a very nearby galaxy called the Large Magellanic Cloud. And we had neutrino detectors in Japan and Ohio that both observed a big burst of neutrinos when this explosion happened. And this helps confirm the idea that neutrinos are released in large amounts during a supernova type 2 explosion. That supernova, we actually had images of before the star exploded. And so here's a zoomed in image with an arrow pointing to where the star is. And then afterwards, the star exploded and became very bright. It's brighter than anything else around it. So before and after. The peak brightness of a supernova can be brighter than, as bright or brighter than, the galaxy in which it's inhabiting. So what do we see there today? We see supernova remnants, that is the leftover gas that's been expelled off of the core during the supernova. And so here is a Hubble Space Telescope image, a very wide field view of the area where supernova 1987A occurred. And we can see material which has been illuminated by the shockwave and by the radiation from this event. And so that's the life of a high-mass star up to the point where it explodes as a type 2 supernova. An interstellar cloud of gas and dust collapses to a big main sequence star, spends 90% of its life turning hydrogen into helium in its core, just like any other star, and then expands into a red giant. During this red giant stage, it can fuse elements all the way up to iron, and when the iron core is produced, that's when gravity collapses the whole thing down. We have an explosion and a rebound and a flux of not just material that is being flung out from this shockwave, but also neutrinos, which help push the outer layers into space. This is called a type 2 supernova. What we get after a type 2 supernova kind of depends on the mass of the core before the supernova occurred. And that will be the subject of another video.